Everybody, can nobody do me like Jesus? Hey. He's my
friend. Oh. Hallelujah.
All right.
Hallelujah. Am I right?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. That goes real good with what we're going to talk about today. In the Word of God, I want you to just turn back to that Gospel of Dr. Luke. Dr. Luke. And we're going to lift up the 33rd verse of the 9th chapter. Chapter 9 of the Gospel of Luke, and the 33rd verse. Amen.
Amen.
It's already been read. in your hearing and its context, but we just want to lift up the 33rd verse. Are y'all with me today?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. I'm just checking on you. Amen. Every now and then, you got to have a check. Check with folks. You all right?
Amen.
The 33rd verse of the Gospel of Luke, it reads this way. Then it happened, as they were parting from him, that Peter said to Jesus, "Master, it is good for us to be here. And let us make three tabernacles, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah," not knowing what he said. Let us make three tabernacles. Amen?
Amen.
One for Moses, one for Elias, one for you. Amen?
Amen.
I just want to preach today just for a little while. This is a youth Sunday, so y'all older folks, y'all can listen in too. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Old folks, y'all can listen in too. But you know, it's youth Sunday. Amen?
Come on.
Amen. Selfies with the Lord. I just want to preach today about selfies with the Lord. Pray with me. Heavenly Father, we thank you so much for how you brought us to the place where we are today. Lord, we thank you that you brought us back to worship with you today. We thank you for these young people. Father, right now I ask you to open the hearts and minds of those that are present here in this congregation, that they might be able to receive the word that you have deposited in your servant's spirit. I furthermore ask, Lord, that you would take me and hide me behind the shadow of the cross, that they might not see me, but Christ in me. Lord, please bless somebody's soul today. Cleanse and make them whole. In the matchless name of Jesus Christ, I do pray today. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Amen. Selfies with the Lord. Selfies with the Lord. I know some of y'all just coming off vacation. I know chances are you probably took a few selfies. Am I right about it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, selfies. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right?
Yep.
For those of you that have like a track phone or you have one of those senior phones or something like that, you know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
One of those old flip phones or something like that. You might not know what I'm talking about. Amen. But for the young people, I know y'all know what I'm talking about. A selfie. That's a self photo of you, usually taken with some kind of digital camera or, for the most part, your cell phone. And most of the time you take them, and you take them for the purpose of posting them on some kind of social media site, Facebook, Instagram, Snapchat, I don't know, one of them. Amen. But the idea is to do two things. One, you want to capture yourself in the selfie, right?
Mm-hmm.
And you want to capture yourself in a pose that is flattering. No. Nobody wants to take a selfie in front of a mirror, or take a selfie with a selfie stick and look, wrong. You know what I'm talking about. I've seen some selfie tragedies, as we might say. Amen? I've seen some bad selfies. Nobody wants to do that, but you want to take a photo that's flattering. Am I right about it? And you want to show your friends, and you want to show other folk on Facebook or whatever how jovial you are and how much fun you're having at this place, wherever you might be hanging out. Am I right?
Yeah.
And see, sometimes selfies are taken with other people, you know, just to capture the moment. You know, everybody squeeze in, you know, everybody strike a pose, and the person that got the phone, they want to try to fit everybody in, amen, and take the shot, amen. And you know, selfies are not an old thing. They haven't been around for that long. It's basically a new phenomenon. Am I right about it?
Right.
We didn't have selfies when when I was young. And sometimes, you know, the temptation to take a selfie is not just limited to young people. Amen? True. Young people are not the only ones that have gotten into the selfie craze. And see, sometimes selfies can get you in trouble. Amen? And back in 2013, Barack Obama, the President of the United States, he made headlines when he went to Nelson Mandela's funeral in South Africa. And while he was there, he was, and the speakers, they were eulogizing, you know, these things take a long time for leaders of state and whatnot. The president was taking selfies with the Danish prime minister. Amen?
Amen.
And the Danish prime minister and the British prime minister, they were taking selfies. And it made the world news. Folk were talking about it because in the middle of the funeral, the president of the United States was taking selfies with other leaders of other parts of the world. Amen?
Amen.
And the decision to take selfies was considered a poor, in poor taste. Amen?
Amen.
Like the news media called it, President Obama and the other world leaders were clowning around like Muppets. Amen?
Amen.
And then photographers, they started snapping shots of First Lady Michelle Obama sitting next to them looking furious. Amen?
Amen.
And just horrified. And when the president was talking to the Danish leader, putting his hand on her shoulder, she was kind of fine, you know. The first lady got real upset and she left her seat and sat in between the two of them. That was the end of the selfies. Amen?
Yeah.
Amen. And then back in February 2015, just this year, President Obama, he took a selfie in front of the mirror, sticking his tongue out. And when you clicked on that post that he posted online, it took you to a website that encouraged young people to get involved in the new healthcare act. Amen?
Amen.
To get involved in Obamacare. So the selfie was used for a good purpose. Amen? See, everybody has taken a photo with somebody. Am I right?
Right.
I've taken a photo with somebody, and you've taken a photo with somebody. Sometimes you take photos with pretty people. Sometimes you take photos with not so pretty people. You know, we just take pictures. Amen? We take them to catch the moment. Amen?
Amen?
But selfies center on the individual. Amen?
Mm-hmm.
It's not a picture of you that I want, but it's a picture of me that I want. Amen? I want a picture of me, and you just happen to be in the picture. I want a picture to show everybody me. It's not a picture of you. You know, it's a funny thing about pictures. You know, you can look at a group picture like your high school graduation, or maybe you were on the football team, or you were in some kind of organization, and there can be 100 people sitting on the bench, and you're in the picture, and the first person that you look at is you. Amen?
Amen.
I, the word I, a single letter. It is the most used word in the entire English language. I. Amen?
Amen.
You know, it doesn't matter what you do or where you take your selfies at. You always got to give the event a name. Is that right? No matter whether it's a funeral or a rock concert or whatever it is, somebody is going to take a selfie and give it a name.
Mm-hmm.
Selfies. You know, if you meet somebody, if you meet a movie star, you want to take a selfie. Amen? Now you look at the red carpet, you look on the red carpet, people pulling the stars over and taking their phones out and taking a selfie. They're not taking a picture necessarily of the star, they're taking a picture of themselves. Amen? When the team scores, right, there's a selfie. All the brothers on the team get together and take a quick selfie with the ball in their hand. When you go someplace historic, you go to a monument or something like that, and you get in front of it and you take a selfie. Amen?
Right.
Amen. You want to memorialize that event. That's just us. We like selfies. Right? You know, like I said, that stuff didn't happen a generation ago. Just one generation ago, all we had was what we call the Kodak moment.
Oh yeah.
Somebody know what I'm talking about.
Yeah.
Like, you know, you had the Kodak moment. You didn't have no selfie, but you know, while things were going on, somebody might have a camera. Amen. Because they came out with the portable camera, they got small.
Yeah.
You still needed some film. Or you still needed to let them develop. Amen. And somebody would come and they would say, "Ooh, let me get a picture of that. That's a Kodak moment." Amen. And everybody would be, "Hey." You know what I mean? And they, you capture that picture in the club, or you capture that picture in the park, or at the family reunion. But the difference between the Kodak moment and the selfie is that rarely in the Kodak moment was the person that was taking the picture in the picture.
Right, right.
Amen?
Right.
Although they were there, and it was memories that they were capturing, they weren't in the picture. Self-timers were the best you can do to try to get yourself in the picture back then. You know, you take the camera, and you, if you ain't got no tripod, you set it on the table, and then you set the little timer, 10 seconds, and then you run, and they got the little spot waiting for you, and you get in there and try to get in your pose real quick before the camera snaps off. That was the closest thing we had to a selfie. Amen? And the fascination with putting yourself in the picture has gotten to the point where even pictures of ourselves, when we take pictures of ourselves, and other people, we want to put ourselves in the photo. Amen?
Amen.
That's called photo bombing. You know what I'm talking about? Young people know what I'm talking about. Somebody else trying to take a picture and somebody jump in the back, putting their fingers up over your head, pointing at you or making some kind of face behind your back. Amen. They going to photobomb you, do some signs on you. You know what I mean? In the back of you and whatnot. That's called photobombing. You know, so we done got to the point where somebody else taking a selfie, we want to jump in on theirs. Amen. You know, can you imagine what it would have been like, what the scene would have been like back in the Bible if they would have had selfies back then? Amen.
Oh,
when Jesus went and spoke to a large crowd, you know, some of y'all be running out there trying to get a selfie with the basket full of fish. Amen. Some of y'all be running down there trying to get a selfie with a glass of wine in your hand at the wedding. Amen. Y'all be doing all kind of things if they had selfies back in Jesus' time. Amen?
Amen.
You can hear somebody say, "Hey, Master Peter, come here. We're going to take a selfie." Amen. And we'd all get together and take a selfie. We're among the millions that take selfies every day. Christians are not exempt from taking these selfies. But when it comes to your faith in God, brothers and sisters, young people, our desire should be that He would hide us behind the cross, that no one would be able to see us in the picture. Amen?
Amen.
So that they might see less of us and more of Him. Amen.
Amen.
I want to be used more than I want to be seen. Amen.
Amen.
I picked this passage because it struck me as funny that even back then, folk, when something happened, they were adamant about trying to memorialize that place by giving it to somebody else. Whenever something happens in our lives or something great is done in the world, we want to give it somebody's name. But let me tell you something. If you take things and you give them and devote them to people will mess up. Right now, Disney just took a Bill Cosby statue, his bust, his statue of his head. They took it out of their park. Philadelphia is painting over a mural that was dedicated to Bill Cosby. Somebody's got a petition going around. They want to remove his star from the Walk of Fame. Amen? When you put up a memorial dedicated to a person, that person, sooner or later, is going to mess up.
Amen.
Am I right about it?
Amen.
This is on a special moment on this mountainside, which these individuals were shown this vision of the kingdom, right? So basically what it was, Jesus took Peter and he took John and he took them up to a high mountain to show them a vision of the things that were to come. And so they can fully understand what he was going to have to go through in order to save the souls of humanity. Amen?
Amen.
And as Jesus prayed, the men fell asleep. Amen? They just rocked out. And God rolled back the canopy of heaven and revealed the complete vision for just a moment. Amen?
Amen.
And appearing in that vision was Elijah. And in that picture also was Moses. And they come to show the disciples what the real nature of their mission was, what they were really meant to do. Y'all hanging with me?
Mm-hmm.
And it was such a great vision that the Bible says that Jesus' countenance, that's a fancy word for his look, changed. Said he turned white and began to grow. His clothes turned white and he was shining and glowing. Amen? And Moses and Elijah appeared and they talked there with Jesus. Right? And then at the end of the vision, these three jokers woke up. Not at the beginning. They didn't see the whole thing, what was going on. But they saw the tail end of the vision that was planned for them. And they got so excited about the tail end, and they were half asleep. And Peter wanted to build three tabernacles and stay up there on the mountain. Amen? And it says he was babbling along. Luke 9:33 said he didn't even know what he was talking about. Amen?
Amen?
So Peter missed the big picture, but he wanted to save that moment because it was so great for him. So he didn't see the vision of Jesus going to Jerusalem. He didn't see the vision of Jesus dying on the cross. He didn't see the suffering of Jesus, but he saw the tail end of the crucifixion where Jesus was being risen and glorified with Moses and above Moses and Elias in heaven. Amen. And they wanted to capture that moment. Amen?
Amen.
And he wanted to build some markers there to let the world know what happened and what exciting thing happened to us on the mountainside. And it would also let the world know that he was there. Amen? Because that's what we do when we take selfies. You know, we're not too worried about who else is there. They're there. But we just want everybody to know that we were there. Amen?
Right.
See, he missed the big picture. He wanted everybody to know that he was in the presence of greatness. Amen?
Amen.
We got some selfie moments. But then we got some moments when it comes to faith that don't give us any selfies.
All right.
Amen? Because see, your faith experience, the experience, young people, that you're going to go through as you go through life in this faith walk, sometimes they don't provide no selfies.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
See, the faith experience, they sometimes they just don't lend themselves. There are going to be some things that happen to you that God is going to do for you that ain't nobody going to know about but you. You ain't going to be able to take no picture of it. You ain't going to be able to tell nobody about it. Or at least you're not going to be able to tell it all.
Yes.
There have been moments in my life when God has opened doors.
Yes.
Dried up Red Seas for me. But those moments weren't about me. They were about the kingdom. Y'all need to hear what I'm saying today.
Amen.
See, our faith history has taught me that God opens doors for us in connection to the kingdom.
Amen.
That's why I'm always trying to encourage you to do something to build up the kingdom of God.
Amen.
Don't just come to church looking to be blessed.
Yes, yes.
Don't just come in here looking for somebody to sing your song and to make you feel good.
Yes.
Come in here looking to do something to build up the kingdom of God. God blesses as a result of you connecting your talents to the kingdom of God.
Amen.
You know, if God needs some carpentry done, mm-hmm. He's going to take one of you young people and he's going to give you skills beyond measure in carpentry.
Right.
All right. Amen?
Amen?
And see, you can do two things with that.
Uh-huh.
You can go out here and you can build big, beautiful things and you can
right.
take pictures of yourself in front of it and say, look what I did.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. Amen?
Amen?
Or you can devote those carpentry skills to the Lord.
All right.
And build something in his name.
His name.
All right.
That's why we can't point to heavenly.
Amen.
at my ourselves when it comes to this faith thing. You know, folk will come in the church, and I know young people, you might have seen some adults that walk around and they want to brag. You know, some of them know it's wrong to be bragging, so they try to do it real quiet, like, amen. Or they won't do it around the pastor, but when they get around other folk, they want to brag about what the Lord gave them and how he blessed them and, and I'm got this and I'm doing this and all this other stuff, amen. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying today. See, when the disciples worried about paying their taxes, Jesus told them, look here, I want you to go down to the sea. I want you to throw a line in, and you're going to catch a fish. Right. They caught that fish, and in the mouth of that fish was a coin. Right. And it was enough to pay their taxes. Amen? Amen. So it wasn't about them catching a fish. See, some of us, we would have caught a fish. Some of us fishermen, we would have caught a fish and he had all kind of money in our mouth. But we got to take a selfie with that fish. And you know what I mean? You got to let everybody know that you caught a fish. You're the baddest fisherman in the world. Amen? Y'all might have caught a fish, but I caught some money. Amen? It was the Lord that did it, and he did it for the building up of the kingdom, not for the disciples. Amen? It was about providing for the kingdom. That's what I want to let you know today. The money that you make and the money that you get in your lifetime is not just for you. It's not just about you. But God gave it to you so that you would take a believing and having faith in you, that you would take a designated portion and give it to him so that he could build his kingdom.
Amen.
And some of us, you know, we used to have something, now we don't. Some of us been trying to get something and we just can't. Amen.
Amen.
That's because we've been taking selfies with God's money. Y'all don't hear what I'm saying today.
Amen.
You've been taking his money and making yourself look good with it.
Yeah.
But you haven't been doing anything or very little. See, y'all don't want to hear me today.
Yeah.
Amen. See, I'm blessed today and you blessed today. And our blessings come so that we can be used to build a part of the kingdom. Amen.
Amen.
We blessed so that we can bless the kingdom's work. Are y'all hanging with me today? It's not about me. I know that every now and then I might be able to sing a little bit. But it's not about me. Amen? It's not about, it's about building up the kingdom of God. That's why I do it. And then you know what? A selfie is not a self-portrait. Did you know that? A selfie is not a self-portrait. See, there's a difference between a selfie and a self-portrait. See, a selfie captures a moment. Y'all got me? But it doesn't paint a picture of who we really are. When you take a selfie, you're not taking a picture of who you really are. Most of the time, we're trying to act like something, or trying to look like we're something that we're not. Amen? We want to look like we're wealthy, or we want to look like we're a superstar. We want to look like we sexy, pushing our lips all out. You know what I mean? We want to try to look like something that we're not. Amen? And see, when the president took that selfie of himself in front of the mirror, sticking his tongue out, it may have shown his playful side, but it wasn't a true picture of who President Barack Obama really is. Amen? And on the other hand, a portrait captures the moods and the feeling of an individual's persona, how somebody else sees it. Amen?
Amen.
See, a self-portrait captures the same persona that is seen by oneself, but in a different way. Jesus asked the disciples. He already knew. He didn't need to ask them. He knew exactly who he was and where he came from and all that. But he asked them, "Who do you say that I am?" Amen?
Amen?
They say, you know, some say you lie, some say you this and that and this other thing. But he said, I'm not interested in that. He said, who do you say that I am? See, Jesus is not worried about what people in the world say that he is. You ain't got to jump up and down and jump on people and defend your faith and the fact that you serve Jesus Christ. You ain't got to jump up and try to convince somebody or call them this or call them this other thing while they trying to talk you down and call you name for serving the Lord. Amen?
Amen.
You ought to know who the Lord is, and that's it. You don't have to defend him. He said, who do men say that I am? But then he said, more important than that, who do you say that I am?
Amen.
Amen. And then once they had said who they thought he was, now we think you're the Christ. We know that you are the Christ. He told them, I came that you might have life and have it more abundantly. He painted a self-portrait. Let them know exactly what he came for. See, listen. As believers, brothers and sisters, you ought not be interested in being seen doing the work of the Lord.
Right.
Somebody ought to help me in here.
Right.
Some folk always want to be seen doing the work of the
That's
Lord.
Right.
God is not. Let me tell you. Oh, I wish somebody would catch this today. The ones that want to be seen doing the work of the Lord, you not being blessed half as much as those that are just doing the work and ain't nobody around. Somebody gonna help me here in a minute. The folk that think they being blessed because they standing up front and folk is looking at them and they get to shine and they get to wear fancy clothes and they want to speak fancy. The Lord is not blessing them half as much as the little lady that came in and cleaned the church when nobody was. Y'all don't hear
that.
Amen.
Listen. You need to understand God is not going to bless you just because you've been seen doing something. Amen? That's just like Peter and James and John missed on. That's what they missed on the mountaintop. See, they didn't see how they fit into the big picture. And for many of us, because we haven't gotten involved in the church, we can't figure out how we fit into it.
Amen?
We haven't tried to do anything for the Lord. So it looks like there's nothing here for us. There's plenty here for you. All you've got to do is decide to do something. Can't nobody force you to do it. And ain't nobody going to beg you to do it.
That's right.
Amen?
Amen.
They wanted to be seen. Amen? They saw the moment and they wanted to preserve it so that everybody could know we was here. Amen? We was here. There are a lot of folk that want to photobomb the work of the Lord. Amen? They want to get a photobomb in there. They're not really doing nothing. Amen? And they might talk down everything you try to do. But as soon as it get done, they're the first ones jumping up talking about, look what we did.
All right, tell it,
brother. They done photobombed. They in the picture now. Amen? They in there with you. Amen?
Amen?
They want to be seen out in front. Amen? They not happy. If they can't be seen out in front, well, they can't just sit out there. They got to run up on the stage and whisper something to the past. Ain't nothing important. They just want to be seen.
Go ahead now. Go ahead, talk.
Y'all don't hear what I'm saying? They want to photobomb the work of the Lord. Amen? You don't see them, they ain't even got to go to the bathroom, but they want
to.
I'm here. Amen? They want to be seen. They want to photobomb the work of the Lord. They insist on their name being called. They insist on their name being written in the program. They want a picture of themselves. Amen? So that people can see it. And your insistence on capturing the lamp, the limelight and refocusing the attention on you, that runs counter to the teaching of Jesus. Everything that you learn, you're trying to look big, but that lets everybody know that you don't really know the teachings of Jesus.
Amen?
Amen. Matthew 6, Jesus said, the person who wants to photobomb the offering, let everybody know, let everybody see what he's putting in, well, he already got his reward.
Right.
Amen?
Amen.
He said, the person, in Matthew 6 and 5, he said, the person that wants to photobomb the prayer meeting, let everybody know that he's praying, wear bells on his gown, and let everybody know that he's praying in the synagogue, and he's praying out in the middle of the street. He want to photobomb the prayer meeting. He already got his reward. Amen?
Amen.
Matthew 6 and 16, the person who wants to get attention in the church by photobombing the fasting. Amen? You know, some folk fast, they don't say anything. Other folk, they want to let everybody know, oh, I'm fasting. Yeah. Jesus said, look, if you're fasting, go on fast, but wash your face.
Right.
You know, moisten your lips. Don't sit around trying to look sad so everybody know that you're sacrificing. Amen? You already got your reward. Luke 9 and 23, Jesus said, he said to them, if any man will come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross daily and follow me. What he's saying is don't photobomb the work of the church. Amen?
Amen.
Don't just put yourself in there trying to always let everybody know what you're doing for the Lord.
Right.
So that you can look good. Somebody.
Amen.
Leroy, somebody going to get me today. Somebody going to understand what I'm saying today.
Amen.
It's not about you.
That's right.
It's about the Lord.
Amen.
It's about God's glory.
Amen.
Listen, I know you're getting tired. Your attention spans have shortened. Amen. Because of cell phones and microwave. So I'm going to let you go. Amen. But brothers and sisters, while you try to remove self out of the kingdom and out of kingdom service, God sees every single unselfish act and rewards you with some precious moments that only you can share in. Only you know about. You know, Kodak talked about the Kodak moment. And it was a special moment, and it was worth saving. Amen?
Amen?
But, you know, I got some special moments, too. But I call my special moments God moments.
Amen.
Y'all don't hear what I'm saying today?
Right.
See, there are moments that you can't photograph. You can't post them on Facebook. Ain't nobody gonna see them on Instagram.
Amen.
And there are moments when God stepped in your life, worked a work that couldn't be seen. You didn't even know what was happening.
All right now.
But when you look back over it, you realize that he was the one that brought you through.
All right.
You see, David had a lot of God moments. When he faced a wild bear, a wild wolf that threatened his father's flocks, he had a God moment. Amen?
Amen.
One day he faced a giant named Goliath.
Uh-huh.
And he had a God moment. When he was chased down by King Saul, treated like a criminal, he didn't have a Kodak moment, but he had a God moment. When I get faced with some rough decisions, I have some God moments. Moses was leading the people, and he climbed up the mountainside because he was tired of leading these negative people. And he talked with God. And God spoke to him and showed him the way. That was a God moment. Have you ever spoke to the Lord and he showed you a way out of no way? Abraham was a great man of faith. Took God at his word that his family would be blessed and he would multiply if he moved in God's will. The moment he accepted God's will, that was a God moment. Anybody in here remember the day you got saved? Anybody in here remember the day that the Lord touched you? That wasn't a Kodak moment. You ain't got no pictures of it, but that was a God moment. Daniel refused to be intimidated by the prospect of the hungry lions. He went into God's protection. That was a God's moment. There were some Hebrew boys that were about to get burned up in a fiery furnace. They were about to be eternally shamed, but they chose to move in God's preservation. That was a God's moment. Ain't nobody in there see it but them. They didn't take no pictures of it, but it was a God moment. In a God moment, you're not trying to focus the attention on nobody else. You're not trying to focus the attention on yourself, but it's only the will of God. It's not about self, but it's all about the Lord. That's why I heard somebody say, I come own. When I got this thing, I came by myself. While the Duke was still on the roses, I heard a voice there. Wasn't nobody there but me. And the voice I heard while I was there, it was like the Lord. And you know what? The joy I shared as I tarried there. Nobody but me knows how good the Lord has been to me. It ain't about me, it's about the Lord. It's good to know that if nobody cares, the Lord still is concerned. It's good to know that when you won't forgive me, that the Lord will forgive. It's good to know that if you won't accept me, I got a friend that sticks closer than a brother. It's good to know when you don't want me, I got a God that will take me in. It's not about self. That's what Jesus showed when he went to the garden to pray. He said, Father, I did what you asked me to do. I've established the ministry. I worked in the church. I fed hungry people. I healed sick folks. I prayed and raised the dead. I know the plan that you got for me is to go up on Calvary. But if there's any way, please let this come pass. But nevertheless, not my will, but thy will be done. It wasn't about self. It was about saving you and saving me. He died on Calvary. But early Sunday morning, got up with all power in his hand. He did it for me, not for himself. I don't know about you. I sang, but it ain't about me. I cleaned, but it ain't about me. I paid, but it ain't about me. I preached, but it ain't about me. I went visiting the sick, but it ain't about me. I lifted hands, but it ain't about me. It ain't no selfie. It's all about the Lord. Ain't he all right? Ain't God all right? He healed me. He raised me. He delivered me. But it ain't about me. It's all about the Lord. Ain't he all right? Yeah. I need somebody that can say I had a moment with the Lord. I need somebody that was sick and the doctor said no way, but you had a moment with the Lord. I need somebody who thought you was gonna lose your mind, but you had a moment with the Lord. Ain't he all right? Ain't my God all right? Yeah, yes he is.
Listen, if you had a God moment, y'all got to help me. Yeah. Come on, y'all got to help me. He said, if I be lifted up, don't just sit there like you did it all yourself. He said, if I be lifted up, I will. I know you paid those bills, but you didn't do it yourself. I know you got back on your feet. You didn't do it yourself. Don't sit there like it was all you. Give him some praise. Hallelujah. 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 He's good. Yes, he is.
how he set me free. I can dance, 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 dance all night. Think of Jesus, how he set me free. I can dance. I dance all night. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'm trying to end this thing, but I just can't stop thinking about all those nights when the tears were rolling down my face. But God came in the room and let me know it was going to be all right. I just can't stop thinking about laying in that bed, looking up there, all those machines, all the doctors. But I had a God moment that let me know it was going to be all right. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I wish I had somebody that's been through something. And the Lord brought you out. You know it wasn't nothing you did. Matter of fact, when you went through it, the reason why you got in it, you was drinking and smoking and everything else. You wasn't doing it, but he brought you out anyway. You were doing the wrong thing when you got into it, but he brought you out the right way. It's not about me. It's about the Lord. I know the Lord will make a way. Oh, yes, he will. I done found out for myself. I know the Lord, stand to your feet, will make a way. Yes, he will. He'll make a way for me and for you. My God will see you. The doors of the church are open. I don't know, there might be.